Hey friend, welcome back to the channel. Are you still confused by all the principles, all the types of machine learnings that are out there? Maybe you've been working as a data analyst or data scientist for some time, but you still get confused with what to choose and why, and deeply understanding what's going on behind those machine learning models. So in this video, I want to simply walk you through all the machine learning types, what they mean, when to use, for what purpose, in what use cases. I created a simple document we're gonna go through right now. This is mostly theory, but it's always important to understand the theory behind machine learning and what you're using, because nowadays there are some really good AI tools that can help you to code, but they don't help you to think. And in this video, we wanna make sure that you understand the fundamentals so that you can use them and apply them in your own work. Let's jump into my computer. Okay, so here we are now on Google Docs. I've created this simple doc in here called Machine Learning Fundamentals that we can go through right now together. So what is machine learning? It's a branch of artificial intelligence that enables computers to learn from data and improve their performance without being explicitly programmed, even though there is a lot of programming involved, but it means that we write an algorithm that will learn from itself, make predictions, and get some improvements over time. Unlike traditional programming, where instructions are written explicitly, like it's like a hard coding kind of program where you say one thing and it has to be done, ML algorithms learn rules directly from data. And that's why machine learning is really the basis of all the AI technologies that we see nowadays. And that's why it's important to understand what's going on behind it. Key concepts. We have training data. Obviously, when we want to train a model, we want to train it on historical data. So there is a training data involved, and there are examples that the model will learn from so that we can make predictions that what we will see later on. There are algorithms. There are simple mathematical methods that learn from data. And machine learning is basically statistics, and statistics is basically mathematics. So all this comes from applied mathematics. We have models. Models are patterns learned by algorithms used to make predictions. And we're gonna see that there are many different types of models. Each and every one has a different approach, statistical approach, to making predictions and to using the training data. And finally, we have predictions, which are the outcomes generated by the trained model. And this is what we look for. This is what we look for improving. And that's really the thing that you're paid for, is to make those predictions. The types of machine learning, we have mainly three types. We have supervised, unsupervised, and reinforcement learning. And we're gonna dive into each and every one of them one by one. The supervised learning is the one that is most widely used by companies and organizations. And it's basically involves an algorithm that learns from labeled data sets. So we have data sets that already have labels, and we train the data on those historical data sets, and we can make predictions from things that were already existent. And in our case here, we mean that each data point has an associated output. We can see here in this visual, let me zoom in a little bit, we have three attributes: car brand, year of make, and mileage. And we can create and write a code or a model that can predict the car price. Because if we know the brand, if you know the year of make and the mileage, usually we can somehow predict the price of the car. And that's what is a supervised machine learning model. It's when we already have those attributes or those features, and then we're gonna predict either a continuous value or a categorical value, which will be the subcategories we're gonna talk about afterwards. So essentially, the model is supervised by the known answers during training. So that's how you should remember supervised. You already have the historical data set and the attributes to train your model. Then we have two subcategories in supervised learning. We have the classification and we have the regression. So when we talk about classification, we predict a category. So for example, we can say that a person has some sort of illness. We can say yes or no. This is a category. It's either a yes or a no. If someone has cancer or someone won a game, we can have it as a classifier, one or two. For example, if we have some units of measure from 1 to 3, and we want to write an ML model that will either categorize based on the attribute if it's 1 or 2 or 3. This is a classification. It's based on categories. And examples here, we can see credit risk analysis. So predicting loan defaults. Is it low, high, medium risk for a bank? So this is a categorization or classification. Email spam filtering. Is this email a spam or not a spam? This is also a classification. Medical diagnosis, as we said, is that person healthy or does the person have a disease? Sentiment analysis. We want to know if the customer review were positive or negative. We also want to know the customer churn prediction. So these are all examples of classification, just so that you have more of that, a deeper understanding of what's going on there. We have a lot of models, and the goal of this video is not to dive into much how to use each and every one of them, and it's not really hands-on. This is more of a theory. But here are the most used ones and the most famous ones from what I know. We have logistic regression. This one is quite simple, interpretable, and fast to train. Even though it's called logistic regression, it is a classification model, which is crazy, I know, but it is what it is. It's used a lot for binary classification tasks. We have random forest, which handles larger data sets, which will be one of those that you might use more often. I do anyways. So with the XGBoost, which is also based on the random forest classifier. So you have all these. We have support vector machines. We have KNNs, which is K nearest neighbors. So there are many machine learning models, and to understand each and every one of them, we can make videos on them. If you're interested, we can really dive into understanding the how and why behind each and every one of those and where they can really benefit you with examples. But for now, just know that there are many classifiers and that you can go and try and just see what results you get from them. Then we jump into regression. Regression is the second subcategory of supervised learning, which is used to predict a continuous numerical value. So for example, when we saw earlier the car price is not a category. We can't say the car price is zero or one. It's a number, it's a continuous number. It can be 50,000, 65,000 and £400, whatever. It's a continuous value. So it's a regression model. And it's used here so for house price prediction, sales forecasting, basically anything that has numerical values continuous that are changing over time. Energy consumption, life expectancy, it's not a category, it's a continuous numerical value that changes over time. So that's regression. And also for regression, we have other models. You can see there are similarities, for example, random forest. They also have a classification model and also a regression model. Support vector, gradient boosted trees. Here I added neural networks. Neural networks, we talk more about deep neural networks, which are more into deep learning instead of machine learning. But the logic is there. It's a machine learning model, it's more advanced, it uses neural networks, more of connections to predict the best output. But it's good to mention that you can also use deep learning models even for regression. So here we have an example of classification, assigning labels categories to inputs, spam detection in emails. So that was just an example there. Here we have a quick hands-on demo here. So we can see, for example, here, this is called Iris dataset. And Iris is just a dataset about some flowers. And they determine which type of iris it is based on a few attributes, as we mentioned at the beginning here, a few attributes. And those attributes were the width of the leaf and the height and all those things. And here we can see to classify, for example, if we had inputted some values, attributes, and it was in here, we can clearly see that we're closer to where this category, the purple one, is. And this one, for example, is using the K nearest neighbor classifier, which basically in this case says that the three nearest neighbors, we're going to identify the class with the three nearest neighbors. Let's say we choose this one here. The three nearest neighbors by distance are this one, and this one. So there are three of them are purple, so we're going to classify it as purple. If it was, for example, in here, and we can see that the closest maybe is green and two yellows, let's say it will be yellow. So that's how it's going to classify. Obviously, no machine learning models are perfect or 100% accuracy, but you get as close as you can from the best accuracy possible. And supervised learning, on the other hand, uses unlabeled data. So we don't have the attributes like we had in supervised. So this one aims to discover hidden patterns or grouping without explicit guidance. So if we see this picture here, we have raw input. We just put a bunch of fruits in there. We didn't say if there were bananas or apples or oranges or anything. But if we use an unsupervised learning model, it will categorize or take each and every one of those categories and put them separately. And that's how we can use unlabeled data, and we can then label them. So there is no explicit right answer given. Instead, the goal might be to discover hidden groupings, correlations, or anomalies. Unsupervised learning is often used for exploratory data analysis or as a pre-processing step. Because usually if there was a data processing, then all the columns will have their attributes or the features, and it will be easier to then do some supervised learning or anything else with it. Here, when we look at unsupervised machine learning methods, we see there are many. One of the most famous ones is clustering. Clustering groups similar data points together based on inherent patterns. Examples, we have K-means, which is a really famous one, hierarchical clustering, and DBS scan, and so on. So the applications, we can see customer segmentation, social network analysis, image segmentation. So unsupervised is used in so many different also domains. We have dimensionality reduction, anomaly detection. This one is very much used in cybersecurity, fraud detection, anomaly detection, predictive maintenance, because many times we don't have specific attributes that we can leverage, but by just putting the data and writing an unsupervised machine learning model, we can then just identify some groups of patterns that we can leverage to either say, okay, this is normal, this is not normal behavior, what can we do about it? With topic modeling, for example, he extracts underlying themes or topics from large collections of documents. So you can put a large document and then, okay, we'll identify some groupings and some categories that you can use afterwards. Autoencoder and so on. I can share this document with you so you can have a look as well, and you can come back to it as a refresher. I use it myself sometimes just as a refresher so that I don't get lost into too much information. Sometimes it's good to understand the basics. Here, a simple clustering. We can see it's an isolation forest trained on a toy data set. So we just put the data set of a toy data set. There was no categories in it. And here we can see, okay, there is a massive grouping of yellow in here and a massive grouping of yellow in here. So these two might be some two big categories of toys. It could be, I don't know, some manga toys or some dolls like Barbie. And the rest are considered outliers because there weren't much of a category to regroup them together. And then we can just look at these and try to understand what they are and then categorize them. That's why it says that it's a pre-processing step for some cases, like this one. Here, for example, it says an isolation forest trained on a toy data set where normal data forms two distinct clusters, the yellow ones, and anomalies are the scattered points far from those clusters. The algorithm isolates outliers by randomly partitioning data. Fewer random splits are required to isolate an outlier than an inlier. In this way, the isolation forest flags points that stand apart from dense clusters as anomalies for further investigation. And this is also used in cases where there is a lot of cybersecurity issues like banking or some fraud detection. And usually you have all the users that behave in a certain way and you have one that completely behaves weird. And that's why you flag it. You say, okay, there's something wrong here. And that's why you use unsupervised learning a lot. Then we have reinforcement learning. And reinforcement learning is a learning paradigm where an agent learns how to make decisions by interacting with an environment. There are no labeled examples of correct behavior. Instead, the agent receives feedback in the form of rewards for its actions and seeks to maximize the cumulative reward over time. Let's have a look into this visual. So how does the reinforcement learning work? We have here, it gives you a rough idea of what's going on. We have an input raw data. We just throw in data out there, not categorized, nothing, just raw data. It will be put into the reinforcement learning model, and it's an agent that will explore the data. It will understand the state of the data, get rewards for it, find the best actions, and select the best possible algorithm. And then it will give you the best output based on all the reasoning that happened behind it. So it's quite a complex model to use overall, but it's so powerful and it's used in most of the biggest tech tools that you use these days. So in a typical reinforcement learning scenario, an agent observes the state of the environment, takes an action, and then receives a reward and a new state from the environment in response. Over many cycles of interaction, the agent's goal is to learn policy or strategy of choosing actions that yields the highest long-term reward. This trial and error process is what allows the agent to improve its performance with experience. So the goal here is that we keep iterating, bouncing back, learning from the previous output, and trying to improve the model over time. That's why it's called reinforcement learning, because we keep improving and iterating on the model. We can see here a few projects where we use reinforcement learning, game playing with AI. This has been huge recently with Microsoft Xbox releasing AI within the games, not just for the side quest players, but also inside of the storyline. And here it's just to add a little bit of strategy and just improving the overall experience of playing games. Autonomous driving simulator. So autonomous driving also needs to have a reinforcement learning model that can improve the ability to not make any mistakes over time. A robot arm control, automated trading agents, traffic signal optimization, any things that are quite complex in theory but needs to be improved by taking in additional information, taking in additional experience so that the model keeps improving over time. And some real world applications for all the categories. You can see, for example, in finance, we had fraud detection, which is massive. It could be a classification or an anomaly detection model. Stock price prediction, it's a regression model in most cases, could also be reinforcement learning. Healthcare, if we talk about disease diagnosis, it's a classification. Or medical image analysis, could be a clustering or classification. So these are just examples for you to, when you think of a project or a problematic, you directly think, okay, what data do I have? And what type of machine learning model I can use? And then you can start thinking of, okay, I want to use XGBoost or decision tree, but it's the reasoning behind it that I wanted to show you today and explain to you today. And here is a simple conclusion. Machine learning helps computers learn from data and make predictions without explicit programming. We talked about supervised, unsupervised, and reinforcement learning. They're all the foundational machine learning model, and all the things that you see nowadays in AI, they take their learnings a lot from this, from statistics, from natural language processing, of course, but this is very important to understand for all data scientists, data analysts, machine learning engineers. Whether you're a beginner or a professional who needs a refresher, I hope you enjoyed it. And if you did, leave it a like and comment with anything maybe that I've missed or some experience they want to share. I'd be happy to read all of it. Thanks for watching.